Buenas noches, bienvenidos. Vamos a fijar el comentario. Conversamos con John Turk, Sub-Zero, el Mortal Kombat. Así que bien fijadito ahí el comentario. Buenas noches para todos. Me dicen si se escucha bien, si se ve bien. Así que muchas gracias a todos los que se están sumando por ahí. Vamos a conversar con John Turk, que fue quien encaró a Sub-Zero sin máscara, a Reptile, Noob Saibot, Rain y un montón de personajes más. Así que vamos a conocer también un poquito sobre su carrera, sus experiencias, lo que es encarar a un personaje de un videojuego, pero aparte también él tuvo participaciones en series como Prison Break y tuvo una participación también en acá lo tenemos, vamos a ir. La película de Batman, así que ya lo vamos a sumar y vamos a sumar a Tadashi también. Hello there.
How's it going?
Fine, thanks, and you?
Yeah, real good. I just got done with the Comic Con here in not California, in North Carolina, in the States, yesterday. But yeah, it was real good.
Yes.
A lot of fun.
How was the experience?
Yeah, it was a real good experience. It's good to be back. You know, everything closed down for so long, so now it's up and running again, and hopefully we're gonna have more of them. And yeah, look forward to going to a few more this year. We're scheduled to do like two or three more, so we'll see what happens.
And
Alejandro.
also it's your first Instagram live, so
Alejandro.
we are making the first live interview with you, so it's such an honor for us.
Yeah, I've usually do them taped. I've never done them live, so hopefully nothing crazy happens.
No, no. We want to thank you for your time. It's an honor for us, and I want to introduce you to my friend Tadashi over here, who is going to translate
Hi.
to Spanish.
Yeah, awesome. Nice to meet you.
Yes, nice to meet you too. I'm going to be your translator for tonight.
Yeah, I'm gonna try and put my earbuds in. I didn't have. I'm gonna get them in here real quick so
Okay,
I can hear
great.
you good.
Yo había fijado el comentario, pero lo perdí. Vamos a ponerlo de nuevo.
Much better. I can hear you now. All right, much better. Yeah. So we got
Vamos.
finished yesterday. We had our
Okay.
the one in North Carolina and met a lot of fans. We had a really good time, and we got another one scheduled. I mean, they're actually doing some through Zoom now. So there's like a convention coming up. I just got a notice from my agent about doing a Zoom convention where I guess everybody's going to be online and just, you know, having a meet and greet and the chats and stuff like that, and talking to the fans, and then they're going to do autographs through the mail too. So we'll be signing pictures and sending them out that way. So it's pretty interesting. Things are changing, times are changing, and we're just rolling with the changes, man. We keep playing Mortal Kombat and keep rolling away.
Ahora, si quieres traducir ahí, amigazo, y ya arrancamos.
Okay, I will translate what you said. Él dijo que en realidad ahora está con las convenciones por Zoom y que los tiempos están cambiando y que se tienen que adaptar, tienen que seguir jugando Mortal Kombat, tenemos que seguir con todo esto. Así que las convenciones se van a seguir dando de manera virtual, pero se van a seguir dando.
Excelente. Bueno, vamos a arrancar. Yo le quiero hacer la primera pregunta, es obviamente cómo se mete en Mortal Kombat y cómo se involucra en este hermoso mundo de los videojuegos, cómo le llega la oportunidad de ser el, a mi entender, el mejor Sub-Zero de la historia.
Okay, how did you get into this Mortal Kombat world and video games world in general? How did you become the best Sub-Zero in history?
Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it. Well, I've always kind of been active in sports and in martial arts, and I never was really into acting. I just had people telling me, "Hey, you should get into acting," you know. And I always kind of brushed it off. I was a policeman at the time, and one day I just said, "Hey, maybe I should give this a try." And so I got an agent in Chicago, and they sent me on my first audition, which was for Mortal Kombat. So I went in, and I had to do what's called a live audition. So during that, I had to do a bunch of kicks, punches, and then they even had me doing some other weird flips and moves, which I can do all that stuff. I used to be able to do a lot of different acrobatic type movements, and it went over really well, and they liked it, and they hired me for the Unmasked Sub-Zero because they went a different direction from Behan. And so once I did the Unmasked Sub-Zero, it kind of morphed into all the other characters. So they needed someone to do the other ones, and they said, "Hey, you'd fit really well into these. Would you be willing to do other characters?" I said, "Sure." So then I ended up doing Shang Tsung with the beard and the different type of outfit and a different kind of move he had. And then it morphed into just all the other ninjas. And it was a lot of fun. I mean, I worked a lot. It was a great time. It's unusual because I never, first of all, I wasn't an actor. It was my first time. I just tried it. And right away, I was thrown into one of the hardest situations, which is acting in front of a green screen. So there's no background, there's no
Yeah.
anything, and everything is digitized into the game. So it was pretty, it was hard for me to grasp at first. And like, well, no, we're going to make that. Don't worry about it. They were talking about cutting out certain parts and putting in other parts. And I just didn't understand. I couldn't grasp the concept of somebody digitizing a background in a computer because it really was new at that time. And I wasn't a film guy to begin with. So for me to even understand it was even more of a challenge. But and once I got the hang of it and I saw the first cut and they showed me, I go, oh, I see. Okay. And so it was much easier. And just all the filming was slowed down too. So in other words, whenever I would throw kicks or punches, I couldn't throw them regular speed. They had to be slower because it was hard for them to film it.
Oh,
So
yeah.
when they would digitize it, it didn't translate well. So it was adjusting to that. It was adjusting to the whole filming style. And on top of it, most anyone out there who's a martial artist knows we're moving quick, we're moving fast, we're covering a lot of ground, and you can't. You got to stay in one little space. They tell you can't move past this line, you can't move past this line. So it was just unusual for me in the atmosphere, the amount of space I had to slow down my movements. And I was fortunate enough that I could do all that just because I was really worked on my kicks a lot as far as, form and things. So it translated well for me.
Tenés trabajo en
Okay.
pila, Tachi.
It's a mouthful,
I
right?
have work. Don't worry. Él explicó que en realidad, cuando obtuvo el papel, no era actor, era policía. Por lo que ya venía con un. Y que ya venía interesado en las artes marciales, con un pequeño trasfondo. Así que cuando le ofrecieron el casting, fue directamente para Mortal Kombat. O sea, él no había actuado en nada más anteriormente. Y que lo obtuvo bien el papel porque todos los movimientos que le pedían que hiciera, él los podía hacer. Él decía, hey, yo puedo hacer esto, esto me sale. Así que lo hizo. Y mencionaba que lo más difícil, o sea, John mencionaba que lo más difícil era actuar con el fondo de una pantalla verde, porque en realidad tenía que imaginarse todo lo que iba a estar sucediendo y era algo nuevo para la época. Todo el concepto de digitalizar un set completo o que también dijeran vamos a reemplazar estas partes de acá y esto, así que era como muy difícil. Pero después de que lo vieron sin la máscara, o sea, Sub-Zero sin la máscara, dijeron, hey, necesitamos a alguien para todo el resto de ninjas, para todo el resto de personajes, así que, ¿qué te parece si interpretas a los demás? Interpretó a muchos, y le estoy diciendo muchos personajes más, siete personajes más en todo el juego de Mortal Kombat. Así que, y eso que básicamente le resultaba medio complicado el entender, pero que para la época estaba mortal y que tenía que hacer los movimientos más lento, porque necesitaban registrar bien todas sus acciones de movimiento, entonces tenía que ser más lento de lo que él podía llegar a ir, pero que la pasó muy bien y que se divirtió bastante.
Excelente. Yo quiero preguntar también sobre la diferencia del videojuego y de la diferencia en la violencia. Cuando él era parte de Mortal Kombat siempre fue un juego violento, pero era una violencia, si se quiere, como lo habíamos hablado con Kerry Ann el otro día, era una
Medio
violencia
cómica.
divertida. Y hoy por hoy la Mortal Kombat 11 es hiperviolenta, hiperrealista. Le quiero preguntar sobre qué le parece la violencia actual del juego, si a él le gusta más esta o le gusta la violencia anterior, o prefiere que los juegos no sean violentos.
Well, there's been a notorious change in the type of violence present in the games. Before, way before, in the first game, it was more like a comedic type of violence, and nowadays it's just straight up violence
Yeah.
everywhere. So, which type of violence do you prefer in the games? The first type, or maybe this last one, more realistic?
Yeah, I mean, I think first off, I like a little bit of both. I like in life, I like things to be a little bit comedic and not so serious. And sometimes when it's too violent, it becomes too serious, and it's hard to draw the line, and it goes beyond entertainment into almost a reality for some people. So What I like to throw in is a little bit of comedic references, just so people can. I believe everything in life, you have to laugh at times. Even in bad situations, if you can find humor, it makes it easier to deal with. And even when you're playing the game of Mortal Kombat, it can't be just straight violence because it gets boring after a while. I like the mix of it. I like to see a little bit of humor, then straight violence, and then reality, and then a little bit of humor. And that's the way life is. Life is that way too. You know, it's not, if you become one of something, you become crazy. So a little bit of everything is good. You want to have a variety in life. So I think a variety is good, not just one or the other. And I mean, it's a great question. And a lot of people, I think we're drawn to Mortal Kombat because there's a lot of hidden messages in it. So, for example, the character Noob Saibot is Ed Boon and John Tobias's name backwards. So, yeah, they always have these hidden messages in there, and that's what makes the game interesting too. Which, when you look at the movie, I'm just shocked they don't do more of that because that's what really draws people to Mortal Kombat, because you can find these little hidden messages along with the fighting and the reality of the gore and things like that. But it's what made Mortal Kombat so good, because you had not only had an interactive game that was very realistic and violent and it was fun, but you also had some comedy thrown in it. So you drew in people from both sides. So if you get something too violent, it's going to keep a lot of people away. But if you have something too comedic, it's going to keep a lot of people away. And I think with Mortal Kombat, they found the perfect blend with, I think, the first part and the second half of it, because there was still some comedy in the second half of it, regardless of you know, whether it was more violent or less violent than the first half of it. So I hope I answered that.
Yes, you did.
Yeah. Hey,
No,
and I just want you to
basically.
know too, is to please tell everybody watching that I really appreciate all their support. I love all my fans from Latin America, and I just think you guys are awesome. I really hope sometime I can come down there and meet everybody, because a lot of people have contacted me on the internet, and I just want to say thank you very much, and thanks again for watching and supporting us. We all appreciate it. So I just want to throw that in there.
That's great. That's awesome. Le está agradeciendo a todos los fans, a toda la gente que está ahí atrás mirando el directo, que lo ha apoyado y que le ha enviado mensajes y comentarios. Así que muchas gracias también de parte nuestra por todos los que nos están mirando y comentando ahí. Bueno, vamos con
Acá
su respuesta.
también aprovecho para mandar un saludo a los amigos de Mortal Kombat Argentina ahí, que ahora hicieron una pregunta, que la dejen acá en la casilla de preguntas, porque hablaba sobre, él tiene una está vinculado al fitness. Así que al amigo Mortal Kombat Argentina, que me deje la pregunta ahí, que ahora se la vamos a hacer, obviamente. Perdona que te interrumpí, Tayo.
No, no, no. Vos sos el hoster, José. Así que, bien. Con respecto a su pregunta, él dijo que le gusta la ambas de la violencia, como una especie de balance. Porque en un principio, cuando algo es demasiado serio, es muy difícil trazar una línea entre la realidad y la ficción. Entonces, que también inclusive en las situaciones más serias, está bueno añadirle un poco de comedia, porque así tiene que ser la vida. Si uno es mucho de algo, se vuelve loco. Y que eso es básicamente uno de los motivos por los que Mortal Kombat tuvo éxito, porque metía comedia, metía referencias, guiños, easter eggs en todos sus juegos, y eso era algo que lo hacía especial, por eso los fans todavía tienen una comunidad tan presente. Entonces, yo creo que, o sea, con respecto a lo que él dijo, que la violencia está bien, pero con su cierto toque de comedia.
Excelente. No sé si le querés preguntar algo tú, Tadashi.
Sí, tengo una pregunta.
Dale.
Mi pregunta va con respecto a, él hizo actuación de voz también, no solo física. Entonces, ¿qué área le resultó más desafiante a él como actor? ¿Sí, el área física o la de actuación de voz? Ok, so I read over the internet that you did voice acting too. And my question is about which area was more difficult to you, like acting performance or just voice acting?
I didn't understand the first part of the question. What's harder for me, the physical part, you mean, or the acting part?
The physical part or the voice acting?
well, In the beginning, it was the acting because the physical came really easy. You know, I was younger, I was in my mid-30s, I could do a lot of stuff. But over the years, my body's been wrecked, full of injuries just from sports and from exercise. I've had 9 knee surgeries. I've had my elbow reconstructed, my shoulder reconstructed. I got 40 stitches in my chin, 3 hernias. I broke my wrist. I've been injured like crazy. So as I've gotten older, the physicals become harder and the acting's become easier because I'm a better actor now, but my body in a lot of ways has said I've had enough. You know, I'm almost 60 years old now. I'm 59, so it gets harder as you age. I try to take really good care of myself. I eat really well. I exercise still all the time, but you know, no matter how much we try, it's the aging process still takes over. So I can do a lot more than most people my age, but it's gotten harder to do the physical as I've gotten older. When I was younger, I was reckless, you know. I did everything with reckless abandon, and I didn't have any regard for my body, you know. When I played football, I just rammed my head into anything as hard as I could. When I wrestled and did all that stuff, it was the same thing. And in martial arts, same thing, you know. I wasn't afraid to get hit, so I would run in all my tournaments, and you know, I'd get kicked in the head, kicked in the groin, kicked everywhere, and it was just, okay, I'm gonna win and no matter what. And a lot of times you end up in the ground knocked out and you just get up and keep going. But I look back on those days and I wish I could talk to that young guy and say, hey man, relax, calm down. But yeah, I can't. And I'm living with a lot of my mistakes, but I you know, as they say, my mistakes make me who I am, and I'm happy with who I am right now. I'm happy with my life. I have a great life. I have good family, and I meet great people like yourselves, and it just it makes life more interesting. And what I love about Mortal
Thank
Kombat,
you.
what it's done for me is it's allowed me to meet so many different people from so many different cultures and background. And when I hear the stories of how Mortal Kombat's affected everybody's life, it's so interesting to hear the stories of kids I've saved, not myself, but the game, from taking them off the streets from drugs or in a house that had domestic violence, and they wanted to retreat and get away, so they went in a room and they played Mortal Kombat, and it really helped them get through the hard times in life. And I never realized that. So when I heard these stories, it drew me that much more into not only the game, but also my fans. It's like, wow, I wonder what this person's story is, and I wonder what happened to this person. And so when I meet people, I always ask them, you know, what drew you into the game? What got you into Mortal Kombat? And there's always a really cool story behind it. And sometimes there isn't, but most of the time, somebody's like telling me something. I'm like, wow, I had no idea, you know? And you know, too, what I found is a lot of the gaming fans, am I saying too much here for you to translate, or is it okay to keep going?
No, no.
Okay. So
If
what
you want to
happened?
stop now, it's okay for me.
Oh, okay, yeah, I'll stop now and I'll continue
Okay.
on when, yeah, so go ahead.
No, okay.
Yeah.
Con respecto a nuestra pregunta, él le contestó que en realidad capaz que no le costaba tanto el área física porque él cuando era joven, él realizó el papel de Sub-Zero y todos los demás cuando estaba en sus mediados 30. Así que él tomaba muchos riesgos cuando era joven y jugaba, o sea, hacía mucho más deporte de una manera más desenfrenada, que se tuvieron que reemplazar el codo, tuvo puntos acá abajo, o sea, fue un desacatado del deporte, por decirlo de alguna manera, y ahora mismo está en sus casi que 60s. Entonces, que si él pudiera viajar al pasado y hablar con su yo más joven, le diría, hey, cálmate un poco, relájate un poco. Porque todo eso va a pasar factura y que la edad pasa factura, era lo que él estaba diciendo. Entonces, lo más probable es que él ahora mismo hay cosas que no pueda hacer que sí pudo hacer cuando comenzó con Mortal Kombat. Pero después pasó a otro tema y es que es impresionante lo mucho que ha ayudado en la vida de la gente el videojuego Mortal Kombat, que los ha llevado a salir de situación de calle, obviamente, por drogas y un montón de situaciones difíciles, abuso familiar. El videojuego ha sido como ese escape hacia algo en lo que se pueden centrar y que siempre cuando se reúne con fans todos tienen una historia muy interesante o la gran mayoría sobre cómo se metieron al juego, sobre qué los hizo ser fans de Mortal Kombat y que eso lo aprecia mucho como lado de actor porque no solo él es parte de toda esa influencia que tuvo en las vidas ajenas de otras personas, de fans. I think that you can keep going now if you want.
Okay. Yeah, I forgot. I forgot what I was saying. I was trying to remember, but no big deal.
Okay.
Yo le quiero preguntar si ha tenido la posibilidad de mirar la nueva película y si tuviera que elegir una, ¿con cuál se queda? ¿Con la Mortal Kombat del 95 o con esta última?
Creo que él la pudo ver porque mencionó en un momento que en las películas actuales, o sea, que en la película actual no estaban los mismos easter eggs y todo eso,
Sí.
pero le preguntamos.
¿Qué le pareció la película y si se tuvo?
Which is your opinion in the new Mortal Kombat movie? And which one do you prefer, the original ones or this new version?
There's things
The movies,
about
of course.
there's things about the new one I like, and then there's things about the old one I like. And I just think in general with the Mortal Kombat movies, they just really never get the story straight. And the thing about that is it's hard to get the story straight because I even think sometimes the creators don't know the story. I think they go through and they kind of make things up as they go along. But what I liked about the new movie was is I liked some of the comedy in it. Like I thought Kano was funny, and I thought the guy that played Bi-Han, Sub-Zero, was great at what he did. The thing is at times some of the other stuff wasn't that great, and I'm not going to point anything out. I just don't think it's good to talk bad about any one person. I did, but there's things I didn't like. And as far as the old one goes, I thought it was more true to the storyline of Mortal Kombat, like Annihilation and stuff like that. But yeah, it's almost like you want to play the pick and choose. You want to take a little of this one and you want to take a little of that one and kind of blend them all together. Like we were talking about earlier with the game, the funny part or the serious violence part. It's like you want to be able to find a blend of the two that come together. Because it's as interesting as I've listened to everybody talk about the game. Everybody has the same idea that I just did. It's like they liked some of it and they didn't like some of it. And they wish they could have took parts from this older movie and plugged it in over here. So I think what we discussed earlier about hidden messages, they had none of that in the new one. And that's my big kind of complaint with that. It was like it wasn't true to Mortal Kombat. But like for example, I think that I know I was pushing for a while to have a lot of us in the movie from the game. And the reason why is I think as a fan, I would be so happy if like I'm watching the movie and all of a sudden, hey, there's Sonya, or hey, there's Shao Kahn, and because everybody knows us from the game. So if they were to see us in the movie in a little cameo spot, it's almost like another little hidden message somewhere, So it'd be really neat if they could do stuff like that and pull from the game and blend the game into the movie, because there's a lot of people that don't like the movie but love the game, and they're losing that audience that they could be gaining if they would combine the game with the movie. But Hollywood, it just becomes its own entity, and they tend to do things the way they want to do them. And in reality, Mortal Kombat fans they're really smart fans. They know everything about the game, and if you veer off from the plot line or any part of it, they're going to call it. They're going to say it's phony, this isn't right. And that's what's interesting when I went back and after watching the movie, you look at what people are saying, and everyone called everything out. This wasn't right, this wasn't right. So I just think that they're losing the concept of blending the game in with the movie, which is what they should do, and they don't. So that's my main complaint about it. So I'm going to have to say I really didn't prefer one or the other. There's like parts of each that I really liked a lot. And I thought I just really liked Kano in this one. He was good. And I even liked some of the trailers. They picked a good trailer, which was the beginning where she's, pulling the plants, and all of a sudden Sub-Zero shows up and Scorpion ends up with a fight with him. And it was just really good. I liked it, So their marketing was real good with it. So I think that's why it drew a lot of people in initially. And then it somewhat faded off kind of quick, which to me says that the marketing pulled a lot of people in. But as time went on, when people were going to see it, they got disappointed or withdrew from it. So yeah, that's just my thoughts on it. But hopefully I get in the next one. I think it would be kind of cool is if you have, because they killed off Sub-Zero. So, what if his unmasked brother comes back and avenges him? So maybe one day, Scorpion's walking down the street and he bumps into me. And the fans will know me, and I'll just turn around, and he'll look at me, and then he'll walk away, and my face turns into ice, and a scar forms on my face, and then I just smile and walk away like I'm going to get him, you know? So I think that would be like a cool
That
little
will be
scene
awesome.
doing it. Yeah, wouldn't it? I just think it would be really neat to do stuff like that, you know, just because the fans would be like, oh, that's Sub-Zero, you know, or oh, there's, you know, Sonya or whatever, you know. It's like, I think it'd be really neat for, you know, it's interactive again. It's like playing the game again, you know.
Okay. Él en realidad, cuando con respecto a comparar las dos películas, él dijo que en realidad hay cosas que le gustan de las dos, pero que ninguna realmente ha logrado capturar bien la historia de Mortal Kombat. Si bien la primera es como más legal, esta actualmente, esta película como que no logró meterse tanto en la historia. Y que lo que él cree que falta son cameos o pequeños guiños a los juegos, porque hay todo un mercado de fans que son fanáticos de los videojuegos y que la película no les gusta. ¿Por qué? Porque se están perdiendo todo eso de los guiños a los videojuegos, que aparezcan actores de los juegos para traer un poco esa nostalgia a los fans y para que sea esos pequeños mensajes ocultos que él mencionaba en los videojuegos. Ahora mismo estaba hablando del cameo que le gustaría realizar como respecto de que volver a hacer su estilo, ¿por qué no? Sería buenísimo. Y aparte que sí, dijo que la campaña de marketing para esta última estuvo muy bien y que atrajo mucha gente, sobre todo porque en los trailers incluyeron las escenas finales de la película, que son las que están mejor de todas las películas, pero que no, que en el resultado final terminó alejando a la gente, porque los fans de Mortal Kombat saben realmente la historia. Y realmente se van a dar cuenta de todos los detalles que les estás cambiando en una película. Y eso está mal, y eso es distinto, o eso lo adaptaste de distinta manera. Entonces, que los fans saben de eso, pero que Hollywood, al ser una entidad completamente distinta, hacen lo que quieren, en el modo que quieren, en lugar de escuchar a los fans y de hacer una adaptación digna.
Excelente. Déjame que quiero, para no olvidarme, porque le saqué el fijo de comentario, los amigos de Mortal Kombat Argentina querían preguntarle sobre, que nos cuente sobre Fearless Fitness, que es como su programa de entrenamiento. Our friend of us from Mortal Kombat Argentina want to ask you about your Fear Fitness, fitness program. Could you tell us something about it?
Yeah, so when I was going through college, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I just knew I loved fitness. And I didn't know what kind of degree I wanted to get. You know, my father was from the Middle East and he really pushed going to school a lot. And I really wasn't into school at the time. And so I said, all right, just to appease my dad, I got to go get a degree. So I went and decided I was going to, you know, try psychology, sociology, and I didn't like any of it. I just thought, well, what do I love? And I'm like, fitness. What can I do with fitness? So I started to be a PE teacher. That's what I was gearing my degree towards. And I went and had to teach in the university high school. And when you teach in the university high school, they put you in with what are called behavior disorder kids, or all the kids that are having trouble or just, you know, we're not the best kids in the world. And I just had a really bad experience with a lot of them. They were just rude and abusive. And I'm thinking, man, what are they going to do to someone that's, and I, at the time, I, you know, I'm almost 6 feet. I was 240 pounds. I was a big guy. I was a bodybuilder, really strong. And I'm thinking, man, if these guys are coming at me like this, what are they going to do to a woman that's real small or a guy that's real small? And I just didn't feel like teaching was my thing. So then right when I decided that, the college I went to came out with a degree for what's called exercise science. And what that is basically the study of exercise and how it affects the body and biochemically. So I decided, hey, this sounds like a really cool degree. It's what I'm into. So I got my degree in exercise physiology, and then I became a policeman. So that makes no sense. And so when I became a policeman, when I was there, I was, you know, I was really fit. And a lot of the policemen, if you've noticed, I don't know how it is down there, but up here, there's a lot of them that are really not in good shape. It's a life where you work a lot, you work long hours, you don't get a chance to eat right, they eat really bad. So a lot of them are out of shape. And what's sad is a lot of my police friends have died right when they turned 50 after they retire because they've lived such a an unhealthy life. So when I was on a department, I became the fitness instructor. And when I ended up retiring, I said, well, what am I going to do now? You know, I'm done working as a policeman. And I said, you know, I talked to a buddy and he goes, why don't you open a personal training company? He goes, I do really well. He goes, you have a college background in that. I won Mr. Illinois Bodybuilding Show back when I was in 1987, which is a bodybuilding contest. And then I became the Midwest winner of the police and firemen. So in all of the Midwest of the United States, I was number one in bodybuilding for police and firemen. So I was really into it. And so he said, you have all this background. And then I ended up on the cover of Muscle Fitness magazine. I don't know if a lot of you guys know what that magazine was, but back in the day, it was like the world's most popular bodybuilding magazine. And I ended up on the cover of that. So I had all these accolades for fitness industry. And I said, well, what should I do? And I said, okay, I'll do the personal training. And then it just took off. And now I just keep doing that. You know, I help a lot of people all over the world, actually. I don't know if you, I helped, you know, Amir Khan is, he's an actor in India. He's real popular. I helped him train for one of his movies, and then a few other people too, and some athletes. So it's just been really a fun experience for me. What's great is watching people transform themselves, not only physically, but mentally and their health for the rest of their life. And, you know, I think it's so important for people to take care of their body, because if you don't take care of your body, it's not going to take care of your mind. And once your mind goes, your body's going to go twice as fast. So indirectly, your body is more important, because if you neglect that, your mind will go next. And if you see so many people get trapped in their body because of bad health, and then you just slowly see their mind deteriorate after that, like when people get you know, a really bad heart attack or a stroke, and then you just see the after effects of it, and it's just sad to see. And I had it happen to members of my own family, so I just really, really got into health a lot. And the other reason why is because when I was little, I watched people around me die, and they were just unhealthy people, and I was afraid to die, and so I just started really taking care of myself physically at a young age, with my health. And that's kind of how it morphed into the Fearless Fitness, is because I call it Fearless Fitness because the main reason people don't try to take care of themselves is out of fear. They don't know what they're doing, number one. And the biggest thing is they're afraid of failure. So I try to tell people, don't be afraid of the failure. The reason, you know, a lot of the people in this world are successful is because they've failed so many times, but they keep getting back up. And one of those times you get back up is going to be the time that you succeed. So just never give up. Don't be afraid. Be fearless, and that's why I called it Fearless Fitness. So that's kind of my health journey, and how I got into that was through just, you know, watching other people live bad lifestyles, and it scared me, to be honest with you. And I'm not afraid to die anymore. I mean, it just as I've gotten older, I've come in peace with God and myself, and I just really feel it's part of my life now. You know, both my parents passed away. And it was a sad time of my life, but you know, I believe that we're all here going to go somewhere else to a better place, and I just always keep that in mind. And I try to live my life two ways. I try to live my life very healthy, and I try to treat people as I would want to be treated. And I just think that's how we should all live our lives, because I just found that you just never know what somebody's going through when you meet them. You don't know if they're having a bad day, a good day, and if somebody's cranky or mad, you don't know what happened to them. So just, you know, don't get upset. Just try to move on. And, you know, maybe you'll run into them another time and they'll apologize to you. Hey, I saw you last time and I'm really sorry. This is what happened. And you're like, wow, I didn't know that, you know? So again, it goes back to the old, I wish I could talk to that younger me and tell him these same things I'm telling you guys now. But, you know, everything's always 20/20 in hindsight. When we look back on it, it's easy to understand, but at the time we don't understand. So that's how Fearless Fitness was born, was through just my life in general, and people's decisions that they make based on fear.
Yes, of course, it was a nice story, and I think that you can inspire a lot of people, and you have inspired a lot of people with it.
Oh, thanks.
So I'm going to translate it now.
Okay. That's a long
Of
one too.
course, but I don't care. It's what I'm here to do.
Okay.
Así que básicamente él comenzó explicando sus orígenes con el fitness, que en realidad cuando estaba en lo que para nosotros es la facultad, Él estaba como que no le gustaba del todo, por lo que él lo que realmente le gustaba era el fitness, esa era su pasión. Así que decidió ir por el lado del fitness y lo que terminó haciendo en realidad fue siendo instructor de estudiantes, pero no le daban cualquier tipo de estudiantes, le daban estudiantes problemáticos, no los más agradables, por lo que él lleva el razonamiento de si se portan mal conmigo, que soy alguien de casi 2 metros de alto y que soy que tengo un buen físico, ¿cómo se van a tratar a una persona más pequeña, una mujer o como sea? ¿Cómo van a tratar a todo el resto de las personas? Así que simplemente no le gustaba ese ambiente y justo en la facultad sacó un programa para sacar un título con respecto a la bioquímica del cuerpo y cómo eso afecta en realidad el ejercicio, cómo lo afecta todo eso, y él sacó ese doctorado, ese grado, lo sacó, pero en realidad no sé, dice, no tenía mucho que ver porque en realidad me hice policía. Y que él fue policía y ahí vio cómo sus compañeros en realidad estaban en mala forma, porque simplemente o comían mal o porque tenían mucho horario de trabajo y eso los llevaba a una dieta poco balanceada, y que gente que cuando se retiraban morían, simplemente morían, y que eso a él cuando era más joven le generó miedo, por eso es que desde joven está mejorando su salud, todo el tiempo cuidándola. Por el miedo a morir. Y cuando se retiró, simplemente lo consultó con un amigo, ¿qué hago ahora? Y el amigo le dijo, podés ponerte un entrenamiento de fitness. Así que él se transformó básicamente en un entrenador un entrenador personal, y se llama Fearless Fitness porque la idea es sacarte el miedo, o sea, que vos no tengas miedo. La mayoría de personas no hacen ejercicio por el miedo al fracaso. Y la idea es sacarse el miedo y representar un poco lo que a él le pasó. Es que él ya no siente miedo a la muerte. Él nos mencionaba, nos contaba que sus abuelos fallecieron hace un tiempo y que fue una situación difícil, pero que ha aprendido a aceptarlo como parte de la vida y que, o sea, es todo natural que vamos a ir a un mejor lugar y que uno tiene que tratar a la gente como le gustaría ser tratado y tener en consideración que no sabes lo que está pasando la otra persona. Si está teniendo un mal día o te habla mal y vos no lo sabés, no responder de la misma manera y simplemente acompañarlo de una manera más natural, más, o sea, una mejor manera. Entonces, es lo que él representa con su programa fitness, que te saques el miedo, que vivas la vida y que te cuides a vos mismo, porque si no cuidas el cuerpo, la mente va a ir por el mismo lugar. Así que es básicamente lo que respondió.
Excelente. Terminá la voz, tal vez si te voy a dejar la última pregunta, pero justo John nos dijo que tenía que 45 minutos, así que hacele tú la última pregunta.
Okay, this is going to be the last question, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Mi pregunta es con respecto a Tremor, que es un personaje que él iba a grabar o llegó a grabar, pero se fue eliminado de Mortal Kombat. Y tenía curiosidad que nos contara qué fue lo que sucedió bien. If you could tell us about a character that I read somewhere called Tremor, that was a character that was scrapped from the final game that you were going to be in. Do you know something about that character?
What was the name again? Fillmore?
Tremor, like
Tremor.
T-R-E
Tremor, tremor,
more.
tremor. Oh,
Tremor.
okay. Yeah,
Tremor.
I heard a little bit about it, but I don't know. See, what happens a lot of times behind the scenes is you hear rumors come out and people will say things, but it all starts with the back room and what they leak out sometimes because for promotional reasons to get interest into whatever it is that might be working on or trying to promote. So nothing ever really became of that. I don't know if there's anything planned for it, but yeah, I never heard anything more. I heard a little bit like the caller mentioned, bits and pieces here and there, but nothing more than that. Anything that I can expound on or explain more of. It's just there was a lot of stuff coming out, when I was doing the game that they were talking about, going another direction here or going another direction there, and I would hear it. When I was on set, they would say things like, "Okay, we're going to have them do this," and they'd be like, "No, we can't do that because we might have this in the next game," and that's about all I would hear. And The thing with Mortal Kombat is I had to sign what's called a non-disclosure agreement, and usually you have to do that with most games, most movies if you're in them, and that's what I had to sign was that. So I really can't like come out and say that this is what was going to be told or this is what they were thinking of doing because of that of an agreement I signed. So like right now, there's another game that I might be doing that I had to sign an agreement for, and I can't even talk about it, like what it is or what it's going to be done. So it's funny because I'm like wanting to talk about it, but I can't. So yeah, I don't know anything about the tremor any more than what rumors that most people are hearing. So I wish I could tell you more about it. Unfortunately, I can't. So but
Okay, but that's an honest question. I really appreciate it.
no worries, no worries at all.
Okay,
Yeah, I can answer another
dijo que él no
question. I got a
sabe
little
nada.
bit. Yeah, if you guys want another question, I could
Okay.
answer another question. So,
okay.
Okay, I will translate your answer and then we go for another question.
okay, sure.
Él dijo que en realidad no sabe mucho con respecto al personaje que fue eliminado, Tremor, porque muchas veces son solo rumores que se hacen para llamar la atención sobre el producto que se está promocionando y que mucho de lo que él escucha en el set es de no podemos hacer esto porque lo vamos a hacer en el próximo videojuego o no podemos hacer esto ahora porque va a haber un cambio de dirección. No lo puedes contar porque en realidad todos, si participas en un videojuego o en una película, tenés que firmar un contrato de confidencialidad. Por lo que él ahora mismo también nos contaba que está trabajando en un posible videojuego, en un nuevo proyecto, y no nos puede contar por mucho más que quiera, pero esto, que son contratos y temas que, o sea, que él como actor no puede revelar y que ojalá nos pudiera contestar más sobre ese personaje eliminado, pero no puede porque no sabe directamente.
Excelente. Bueno, ya que vamos a hacerle alguna pregunta más, le quería preguntar, en esta era de servicios de streaming, de Amazon, de Netflix y un montón más de HBO, si le gustaría ver, no una película, sino una serie live action de Mortal Kombat y obviamente si le gustaría formar parte como Sub-Zero. Sí. ¿Qué le parece esa idea?
Well, would you enjoy a live action series about Mortal Kombat and you being the main Sub-Zero?
What
Now
was
with
it?
all these platforms and now with all these platforms and media with the streaming devices, would you enjoy a live action series about Mortal Kombat and you being the main Sub-Zero perhaps?
Yeah, I mean, it'd be really cool. The only problem is I can't do a lot of the kicks and the flips and all that stuff. My body just doesn't want to go that way anymore.
You can have a double. That,
We have CGA, don't worry.
So yeah, I would love to. I mean, there's talks a lot of times about recreating certain things with Mortal Kombat and going different directions with it. I just don't know what's serious and what's not and what's talk and what's real. It's just, especially with the 30-year anniversary coming up, there's so much hype and so much talk going on. I don't know what's real and what's not, especially because Midway Games, who I did the original Mortal Kombat with, they don't own it anymore. It's owned by Warner Brothers. So now you have a whole nother entity, which is a film company, that's going to take over the Mortal Kombat name, and they might run with it a completely different way. And one of the things I wish they would have done is I thought the Johnny Cage was a cool character. Now they're talking about maybe making a Johnny Cage in one of the next films. So it's entirely now. Everyone is at the mercy of Warner Brothers because they own the rights to Mortal Kombat now. So, like for example, I just had to find out about just making T-shirts with the phrase Mortal Kombat on it and putting my picture on it. Would I get in trouble? Would they try to sue me? And I asked some of the people at Warner Brothers. And the bad thing is you could never find who to talk to. It's like you get passed from person to person to person. And then you never get a straight answer, like, oh, I could tell you this, but you really can't talk to me. You got to talk to this guy. Then this guy passes you off. And it's almost like they're built-in filter systems, so nobody gets to do anything, but they never really say no. You know what I'm saying? So they
Sure.
pass you around. Nobody ever gives you an answer, but they never gave you one you didn't want to hear. So it's like this huge conglomerate organization now runs Mortal Kombat, and the little guy, like the fans and a lot of the other people that want to do maybe knockoffs of Mortal Kombat, really can't do anything because It's like this big bear is holding on to the body of Mortal Kombat and not going to let it go. And everyone else underneath is wanting to know more, but we never get to know more. So that's the sad part when it got sold to Warner Brothers, that a lot of the people and fans, they get lost in the shuffle, and it becomes this big Hollywood artistic creation that loses complete sight and complete concept of what drew fans in originally to the game of Mortal Kombat. So that's where we're at right now. I don't know. I would love to be involved in something like that. That's why I was really trying to push for myself to get into one of the new movies coming out, because I really want to be part of it. I think it's a great series. I like it myself, obviously. And I don't know what they're going to do with it. I just hope that they use some of us. And if they decide to go another direction with different types of media for Mortal Kombat, I would love to be involved in it. So I always feel like the Mortal Kombat fans are my fans. I mean, I've done other acting jobs, but I've just found that, as I mentioned earlier, everybody I've met, everybody has been so nice, so warm, and so accepting and loving. I get so much love from fans, and it's every time I do, it's from fans of Mortal Kombat, and it's not fans of other movies that I did. And I just want to say I really appreciate everybody, and you guys are the best fans in the world. And I just want to do more so I could meet more of you guys and just keep going and talking and discussing all things Mortal Kombat. So
Traduce, amigo
it's
a long one.
Tagashi. Ok, él dijo que sí, que le encantaría formar parte de una nueva serie. Obviamente, capaz que no, no
Tengo uno de Mortal.
sería
No,
capaz de
tengo uno de Mortal
realizar.
Kombat que está tremendo, pero lo estoy buscando. Me cagaron acá.
Está, que capaz que le gustaría formar parte, pero no sería capaz de hacer las mismas acrobacias que podía hacer hace 30 años, por lo que habría que cambiarlo de alguna manera. There you go.
I was
Y
playing, sorry.
que y que en realidad ahora Mortal Kombat, la franquicia, fue comprada por Warner Brothers. Así que todo lo que se quiera hacer de la franquicia está a su merced. Ahora está a la vuelta de la esquina el 30 aniversario de Mortal Kombat. Y es todo rumores, no se sabe qué se va a hacer, qué se va a anunciar, cómo lo van a tomar, porque todo está a merced de Warner Brothers. Y que hasta lo han amenazado con, o lo han podido llegar a amenazar con demandarlo, por si él llegaba a
No,
hacer remeras que
él
dijeran Mortal Kombat. O
a
sea, que
eso.
lo podían llegar a amenazar, eso, que se podía llegar a haber problemas legales ahora actualmente. Si él usaba la frase Mortal Kombat en una remera o como sea con merchandising, porque ahora es Mortal Kombat es propiedad de un estudio de Hollywood y como él mencionaba antes van a hacer lo que quieran con ese producto. Que es muy difícil entrar, muy difícil contactarse con la gente de Warner Brothers porque siempre es entras y alguien te manda con otra persona y esa persona te manda con alguien más, entonces no te quieren rechazar directamente, pero tampoco te quieren dar una respuesta concreta. Y eso ha dificultado mucho las cosas. Pero en última instancia también agradecía mucho a los fans porque todos los que he conocido son gente muy buena, o sea, muy agradables. Y que le agradece a todos los fans que lo han apoyado a lo largo de los años y que lo van a seguir apoyando porque él sabe que aprecian mucho la franquicia y que lo aprecian mucho a él. Así que él está muy agradecido con respecto a los fans de Mortal Kombat.
Excelente. Tadashi, agradecerle por su tiempo, decirle que fue un honor conocerlo, que es una persona con mucha historia, una persona que siempre intenta pregar por la vida sana, por el buen estilo de vida, así que fue un placer para nosotros y decirle que ojalá podamos tenerlo por aquí una vez que todo esto de COVID llegue al fin. Así que un honor para nosotros.
Okay, John, it was an honor to meet you and have you here at the interview. Thank you so much. You're such a nice guy. And we'll be really thankful if you could come here to Uruguay
Oh, I
into our event.
yeah, I would
You're
love
welcome
to.
here.
Yeah, I would love to come there. My manager is Chris Bradley with Knuckle Up Entertainment. Knuckle Up Appearances. You can see him on my friends list if you go on Instagram. And yeah, just contact him. I've told him already. We should go down to, Uruguay. We should go to Brazil, Argentina. We should go to all those places because so many fans are there, and we need to. I'd like to connect with them all. And yeah, so if you want to see us down there, get a hold of him or send the right people over to him, and he'll get us down there. So it'd be great. I just want to say to you guys, I love you all. Thank you for your support. And I really, really hope that someday we can get down there and see you guys and interact and just talk all things Mortal Kombat.
Thank you very much for your time. It's such an honor
Yeah,
for
yeah.
us.
Thank you very
Yeah.
much.
Yeah, you're welcome. Take care, guys. Stay toasty.
Stay toasty.
Take care.
Muchas
Bye-bye.
gracias.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
¿Cómo está este filtro, boludo?
Qué
Está
grande.
tremendo.
Está de más.
Tengo, pero
Además, aparte
tengo.
se ponen los ojos y todo, el aura, está de más.
Aparte de Scorpion de boina, olvídate.
Sí,
Pero tengo
el
para
gaucho Scorpion. Scorpion con el mate. Scorpion
cambiar
con el mate, el meme de Scorpion con
para
el
hacer
mate.
esto. Claro. Alta tele, ya estoy allá, dice. No, no entendía ideal. Bueno, muchísimas gracias a todos los que se sumaron, a todos los que quieran ver la entrevista completa. Ya la vamos a subir al IGTV aquí de Comic Convention Uruguay, por supuesto. Después el amigo Tadashi
Está bastante dispuesto a
lo va a
venir.
subir al canal de YouTube también. Gracias al amigo acá de Mortal
Cierto.
Kombat Argentina. Tenemos que conversar con él, que tiene una colección hermosa de Mortal Kombat y sabe un montón. Así que nada, muchas gracias a todos los que se sumaron. La entrevista queda acá en IGTV. Gracias a vos, Tadashi. Hoy te tocó un arduo trabajo porque respuestas largas y prolongadas.
Sí, pero yo no tengo problema porque es lo que a ellos les gusta responder y quién soy yo para negarles la respuesta. Todavía que
Muchas
estoy
gracias,
acá
papá.
invitado, yo también. Gracias a vos, José, por darme la oportunidad. Y gracias
Un
a todos los que
placer.
estamos mirando ahí.
Y aguante Mortal Kombat, loco. Abrazo grande para todos. Nos
Aguante
vemos.
el Mortal Kombat.